Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Glory Boy by Rick Partlow, narrated by Kyle McCarley. There is no glory in war, yet from the blackness of its history there emerge vivid colors of human character and courage, those who risked their lives to help their friends. Sylvia Cartwright. Chapter 1. I tossed her picture down on the desk next to my bunk and laid back, shutting my eyes again so I wouldn't just lie here looking at it instead of sleeping. But I didn't need the picture to see her. Her image was branded onto my soul. Every curve of her face, every highlight of short blonde hair, every sparkling glint in her green eyes. The blood spattered across her face, the expression of horror as she gasped her last breath. I shot upright in bed and swore softly. I'd drifted off for just a moment, just a half second of sleep, and it had come back. I couldn't get rid of that memory. Despite the drugs and the therapy and the best efforts of the most sophisticated implant computer ever made by humans, I woke up every night with her choking on her own blood, the Imperial Guard cyborg looming over her and heading for me, keeping me from getting to her in time. You were rear echelon intelligence. You were the safe harbor I could always come back to, without worry. Without risk. Bullshit. We were all at risk in this damn war, every single one of us. I checked the time on my head comp and sighed. There was no point in trying to get back to sleep now. We'd be transitioning in less than an hour. I swung my legs off the bunk and felt the cold deck plates under my bare feet. I didn't bother to turn the lights on. I didn't need them. I padded silently to the locker across from the bunk and pulled out my reflex armor, its chameleon camo surface shifting colors in my hands to match its surroundings. I slipped into the thin, cool material and felt it seal itself around me like it was alive, which it was. It was an electrically active biomer culture developed in a genetics lab, its molecular structure infused with super-strength polymer, its surface inlaid with superconductive fibers linked to a control unit in the waist, which also linked to my implant computer. It felt like I wasn't wearing anything, but it tripled my natural strength, and the stuff could detect incoming projectiles and laser sights and selectively harden to give me as much protection as a suit of standard combat armor. It was expensive, developmental gear. Almost as expensive as I was. My gun belt was stowed in a drawer below where the reflex armor had hung. I had been keeping it close ever since Hermes. Ever since that thing had killed Jenna while I watched without a weapon in my hand. Not that the Tahni could infiltrate a starship in transition space the way they had the military base there, but then again, I realized I wasn't being completely rational. I lifted it, its mass and substance comfortingly deadly. Between the heavy Gauss pistol, spare magazines, and the combat knife balancing out the left side, it weighed nearly 10 kilos, but it felt feather light to me. Even if the reflex armor didn't selectively harden with my movements to act as an exoskeleton, the biomer tensor fibers that augmented my natural muscles made me several times as strong as any normal human. It was one of the little things I'd learned to live with over the past few years. I buckled the gun belt around my waist, letting it settle low on my hips, and fastened the holster to my right thigh with another catch to keep the heavy weapon from slapping around and making noise. Stepping into my armored boots, I strapped them down and pulled on my gauntlets, flexing my fingers experimentally. One more weapon to test, the one I hated, the one that was my purpose yet seemed to corrupt my being. Making fists with both hands, I extended my arms and whispered softly with my thoughts into the superconductive artificial fibers that ran the length of my body. A pair of 16-centimeter alloy talons extended out of each wrist with a near silent hiss, their edges honed to an ultra-fine sharpness. There were two self-sealing holes in the biomer armor of my gloves, and two synth-skin flaps on the backs of my hands to allow the blades to extend. They were anchored in the biomer laminae wrapped around the bones of my forearm. Like everything else implanted into my body, they'd been absorbed by living tissue and wrapped with nerves. They were a permanent part of me. I almost turned down this assignment when I found out about the talons. They always made me feel like I was some kind of monster. They made death a part of me. Made me a part of the killing. I'd always hated them. Till Hermes. Now, I relished what I was about to do. Each death evened the scales for Jenna. Leaving the cabin, I walked up to the cockpit. Deke was relaxing in the right-hand acceleration couch, flipping a vibro-shiv through his fingers, not activated. Deke was crazy, not stupid. He was prepped and ready, pulse pistol holstered high on his left hip. "You up for this, Gay?" he asked softly, not turning around, facing the forward view screen. "That," I replied, falling into the pilot seat, "is a hell of a question." The view screen wasn't activated. There's nothing to see in T-space. And I could see my reflection in the polished polymer. Just my head was visible. Everything below that was swallowed up in the blackness of my combat suit. Sometimes I felt like I was being swallowed up too, losing my humanity to the augmentation, losing my conscience to the killing, losing my soul to the war, losing Jenna. Was that face still me? It didn't look much different from the farm boy who left home to be a war hero. Ordinary and plain, broad and honest. My hair was the color of straw, and used to be a bit longer than the military buzz I wore now. I'd always been told that my eyes were my most prepossessing feature. They're an open blue-gray, reflecting the honest, easy-to-read impression of the rest of my face. But it was a mask. As much of a mask as the featureless hood that completed my combat suit. Maybe that was the real me.
"Just remember," Deke told me. "This is an intelligence mission, Cal. We go in, inject the virus program, and get out."
I turned and looked him in the eye. He was my antithesis in many ways. I was short, plain, and stocky. A farmer by nature and appearance. Deke had a movie star's face, lean and handsome, with naturally curly, dark brown hair, swept back in the latest Earth fashion. He was a few centimeters taller than my 1.8 meter, and a bit leaner and narrower. Canaan, my home planet, has a bit higher gravity than Earth. We'd been friends since our first year in the academy, and we were closer than family. He knew some of what I'm feeling, I thought. I didn't know if that helped or not. "I remember," I replied quietly. "I remember everything." We came out of T-space at the minimum safe distance from the planet, disguising the gamma burst by transitioning in a direct line with the primary star. It didn't have a name, just a number in the catalogs. The planet was nothing but a strategically placed ball of mud, but the Tahni considered it the ideal place for a staging area. Space stations had been way too vulnerable to our attack wings, so the Tahni had started basing their operations planet-side. Big mistake. The boys couldn't have penetrated a space station this easy. We rode our pre-jump velocity toward the dark side, our systems unpowered to avoid detection, then fell into the thick, turbulent atmosphere, counting on the stealthy design of our ship to stay off their sensor screens. It was a rough ride through the soup, using only cold jets to nudge us in the right direction. I was linked with the ship, of course. Trying to work the controls manually in that kind of goo would have been suicide. Lightning flashed to our right as we came through the really thick stuff, and I could feel the ionized air shake us like a toy airplane. Deke didn't say a word. I knew he hated this. He loved space, but he hated flying in the soup. Me, I loved flying anywhere. Usually. I brought the Raven down low over the great equatorial swamp, our landing zone mapped out weeks before by a scout team. Bless 'em. One small island of terra firma in that giant mud puddle. They had even put down a defoliant pod to clear out the heavy vegetation for us. We bled off airspeed, not too difficult with air that thick, and headed for the island. A strong updraft hit us, and I had to fight to keep it level. If we'd gone out of control, I'd have had to hit the main drives, which would have not only advertised our presence to several batteries of surface-to-air missiles, but quite possibly caused a backwash of plasma that could have burned through the cockpit and killed us both. That would have been what our academy trainers called suboptimal. Next came the tricky part. I had to bring the ship in low and slow enough to hit the landing jets without setting off the satellite sensors. If I was too low, we'd catch a tree in the belly. If I was too slow, we'd do a nose in. As always, I was just right. The landing jets kicked in at about 30 meters up, and I walked the stilts down to the muddy ground. We settled with a gentle bump on 5 sets of tracked landing gear, and I activated the ship's camouflage with a touch of my thoughts. Gas-propelled netting sprang from pop-open compartments in the ship's hull, and from orbit, it looked like a lump of rotting vegetation, thanks to the lasers projecting that image off of the reflectors in the netting. Sometimes it boggled my mind how much our little ride cost, until I remembered how much money the government sank into us. I powered the ship down and gradually withdrew my mind from the ship's systems. Showtime, I muttered, unstrapping and powering back my acceleration couch. Deke took a deep breath and slowly let it out. It was the only hint he gave that the flight keyed him up. Ducking out of the cockpit, I paused by the weapons locker. We didn't really need heavy weapons for this job. It was supposed to be a quick, quiet, in-and-out sabotage mission. If we did it right, they weren't even supposed to know we'd been there. Yeah, and according to the records, I was supposed to be dead. I popped open the cabinet, surveying the array of high-tech armaments available to us. Pulling out Deke's favored weapon, a developmental man-portable electron beamer, I tossed it to him, hardly feeling its 35 kilos. Then I grabbed my own choice. Like Deke's, mine was an experimental design, procured specifically for the Glory Boys, Special Operations Group Omega. But that was where the similarities ended. Deke's weapon was a subatomic scalpel, designed to slice through heavy armor. Mine was a damned sledgehammer. A bit longer than my arm, it was a boxy, angular weapon with a massive magazine housing behind the pistol grip and targeting optics, and it weighed a good 50 kilos. The developmental, personal version of the larger weapon mounted on mecha and marine battle suits, it fired self-contained cartridges which contained a large, pre-charged superconductor capacitor coil, a capsule of liquid hydrogen, and a lining filled with concentrated liquid nitrogen. When the weapon was fired, the superconductors powered the gun's integral semiconductor laser, which fired through a port in the cartridge and heated up the liquid hydrogen to a plasma state. In the milliseconds after the hydrogen was heated up, the laser fired through it, using the plasma to refocus it and burned an evacuated hole in the atmosphere. The remaining charge from the cartridge simultaneously powered an electromagnetic field, which both contained the plasma and expelled it from the weapon at speeds in excess of 8,000 meters per second. After the cartridge was fired, the lining would break open, cooling the spent casing with the liquid nitrogen, and the cartridge could be ejected. It wasn't as energy efficient as a laser or a Gauss gun. It didn't have near the range of Deke's beamer, and it was as heavy as hell. But within 50 meters or so, a plasma gun had the punch of an artillery piece, and it'd blast through almost anything. Deke didn't think it was stealthy enough, but it suited me just fine. "You really think these are necessary, bud?" he asked me, hefting his beamer questioningly. "Remember 4 months ago?" I looked him in the eye. "On Jiru?" "Yeah," he grinned sheepishly. "Guess you're right." I reached into an equipment pouch and tugged out my face hood, pulling it over my head and sealing it at my neck. "Time to go," I transmitted over my neurolink. "You first." I could see Deke's grin disappear under his hood. It was strange, communicating over the neurolink. You started to feel a bit schizophrenic, like maybe you were only imagining you were talking to someone else. I lowered the ship's belly ramp, and we slowly stepped down it. It was night on this side of the planet, so my head comp activated the passive infrared function of my corneal implants, and everything was suddenly lit up with a pale green glow. The lenses had a thermal imaging option, too, but the input was too confusing for just walking around. So I instructed my control systems to monitor thermal and enhance the image when necessary. I stepped off the ramp, feeling my boots sink into several centimeters of mud. The air was thick here, and it smelled like death.
"Hell of a place for a mission,"
Deke said, his voice muffled by his hood.
"Hell of a place to die," I muttered softly in counterpoint.
We plunged into the swamp and started walking. I appreciated the night. It was a night I could lose myself in. I could let this miserable, dense, steaming jungle swallow me up, concentrate on putting one foot in front of the other to keep the images out of my head, not think anymore. The thinking was making me lose focus, driving me crazy. I tried to open my senses up and wallow in the misery of it, let it drown everything else out. I could hear things out there in the swamp. Strange sounds, like nothing I'd ever heard back home on Canaan. Low moaning, like something not quite human, crying out in dull agony. Like me. It was probably some insect or a little reptile looking for a mate. The really dangerous animals don't make any sound at all until they kill something. It took us a good 2 hours of wading through that miserable shit before the swamp started to clear. We were getting closer to the ocean, and the base. We had to stop at a tide pool and clean off our reflex suits. If their sensors were covered with mud, they wouldn't be able to detect laser sights or incoming projectiles. We hugged the edge of the jungle as we jogged swiftly around the promontory, the ocean lapping softly against the rocks on our right. I could see the lights of the base through the trees, which meant we were probably within their sensor nets. We would know soon if they'd detected us. We'd be barbecued. We came around the horn of the promontory, and we could finally see the base. It was an ugly prefab thing, boxy and lacking permanence, and spread out over a good 5 acres. The biggest structure was the reactor complex, and its flanks were guarded by electromagnetic field generators that could knock down missiles or projectiles and jam the guidance signals for armed drones. Circling those buildings were the planet-side sensor arrays and the satellite tracking dishes, and on the outer edges were the air defense emplacements. Primary planetary defenses were in orbit. Filling in the gaps were the storage buildings and the troop barracks. There shouldn't have been more than 30 or 40 personnel on planet. That was the standard complement for these minor staging bases. I knew that because we'd had to kill every single one of them at times. There were no live sentries outside, and apparently we hadn't been detected by the automated ones, so we just walked straight up the promontory, trying to stay on the hard rock to avoid pressure sensors. This was supposed to be easy. We just needed to find an open computer terminal and feed it the virus program we carried in the modules on our belts. Then, if the Tahni used this place for a staging area, every single ship that accessed the central system here would suddenly find itself targeting and firing all its weapons at the nearest Tahni vessel. Neat trick, huh? A bit too impersonal for me, though. I wanted them to see me when I killed them. I wanted to look into their eyes and hear them spend their last breath screaming in fear, like they'd done to her. We approached the base near the shield generators, sticking near their electromagnetic field in hopes it would give us an extra measure of concealment. Someday, if the war dragged out much longer, I thought they might figure this shit out. But not this time. This time, we made it to the satellite control room without being detected. "I'll go in," I told Deke. Nodding wordlessly, he turned to keep watch. I jerked open the door and stuck my plasma gun in, but there was no one in the outer control room, so I closed the door and checked out the rest of the building. There was nothing and no one, not so much as a ration wrapper. But there was a computer input console, and here was my insertion module. It was easy. Too damned easy, a paranoid part of my mind whispered. Something's wrong. Just on a hunch, I ran a thermal scan of the console. That was some computer terminal. None of the controls had any connections except the input jack. It was hooked up by a power cord to a small, hot blob connected to something cool and dark. A quick chemical analysis with my implant sensors detected a faint trace of hyper-explosives. Shit.
"Cal," Deke called suddenly. "I'm getting some heat sources out at the edge of the jungle. Lots and lots of heat sources."
"Want a weather forecast, pal?" I asked, pulling a small contact bomb off my belt and attaching it to the side of the fake terminal.
"A what?"
I heard the confusion in his voice. Grinning, I hit the control to start the charge's 30-second timer. It was built to blow doors, but I thought it would work pretty well as a detonator.
"Batten down the hatches."
I burst through the door, my chameleon camo shifting to blend in with the darkness.
"A shitstorm's about to hit."
And without further commentary, we started running.
"Where?"
Deke asked, following close behind me. "The beach," I told him, another part of my mind contacting the Raven.
"Yes, Captain Mitchell,"
the ship's AI replied dispassionately. "Take off with minimum thermal signature," I transmitted. "Meet us about 100 meters off the horn of the promontory. Come to a hover as close to the water as you can, and if attacked, defend."
"Yes, sir."
We were only about 30 meters from the building when they dropped in almost on top of us. At least 10 high guard troops coming down on jets of isotope-heated steam in their bulky, powered battle suits. They must have wanted us really bad. My suit felt the laser sights on it, and Deke and I dove for cover behind a maintenance tractor. Crackling electron beams arced out of the darkness to blow divots out of the mud in gouts of steam, and tantalum needles gouged shallow craters in the side of the tractor with rhythmic pings of metal on metal. Damn. This was a trap from the word go. They must have known exactly the sort of target the boys go after and set this place up as bait. They probably didn't know when we'd be here, but they knew we'd come. Strangely, I wasn't afraid. The prospect of death didn't bother me anymore. I was a bit pissed. I'd always thought I'd die in some kind of significant manner, not like a damn rabbit in a snare. Fuck this. I took off, Deke following, despite probably thinking I'd gone nuts, and I took the time to trigger a couple of blasts from my plasma gun at the sources of the laser sights that brushed me. The blasts seemed to rip at the fabric of reality, tearing the night apart with their ionizing fury and detonating at the edge of the jungle with a burst of liberated plasma energy. The battlesuits were armored with about 3 centimeters of tungsten alloy, but the multi-megawatt pulses from my assault gun blew through it like it was plastic, dropping 2 of the troopers in their tracks, their torsos burning. We were running in the dark across that rocky, uneven ground at something better than 60 clicks an hour in a zigzag route, and they were still coming too damn close with those electron beamers. I could see them out of the corner of my eye. Looked like about 2 dozen armored shock troops coming out of the woods, closing in on us. We were over 100 meters from the high guard troopers, but if they could zero on us, they'd jet in on top of us in seconds, and there were some regular infantry moving up behind them. But on the bright side... 29, 30! I pulled Deke to the ground just as one of the loudest explosions I'd ever heard in my life went off behind us. The big pile of chemical hyper-explosives produced a shockwave like a micro-nuke, consuming a few of our pursuers in its gigantic fireball and knocking the rest off their feet. The wave of heat passed over Deke and me, cooking us a little through our suits, but not seriously harming us. Scrambling back to my feet, the blast still ringing in my ears and flaming debris raining down everywhere, I started running again, trusting Deke to keep up. There were no shots at our heels this time, with our attackers still trying to recover from the blast. Their thermal sights, at least, would be useless now. The promontory was covered with burning shit, bathing everything in its flickering glow. They couldn't use surveillance drones either. Their own electromagnetic defenses prevented it. We had to get out of here fast, or they were going to call in air support. There was nothing in orbit, but if this had been a setup, they were bound to have at least ground support fighters hidden somewhere nearby. Raven, I called the ship's AI. Any aircraft in sensor range?
I'm picking up fighter-sized aircraft approaching from due east at 20 clicks, Captain.
Launch a spread of missiles, I instructed Raven, then jink into an anti-sensor avoidance course.
Launching now, Captain.
The Raven carried 12 anti-spacecraft missiles specially designed for the team. Launched by an electromagnetic catapult, they shot out even further on compressed gas jets before their main engines cut in. That kept the enemy's SAM sights from tracing them back to the ship. Linked to the ship's sensors, I saw the glowing darts that represented our missiles impact the sensor blobs that were their fighters, then watched the blobs flare up and disappear. That was one problem down, literally. If we could only make it to the beach. Then, my augment sensors picked up the missile streaking out of the forest. Down! I screamed, diving as far forward as I could. I hit on my chest, nearly knocking the wind out of me. And then, the night lit up, and a shockwave lifted me up again and deposited me a good 5 meters farther on. I landed on my back this time, feeling the rocks digging into my shoulder blades. If I'd still been a normal human, I'd have been dead right then, with my back broken by that fall. But my laminate-hardened spine and augment muscles saved me from that fate, and my reflex armor hardened to deflect most of the warhead's shrapnel. The few of the tantalum needles that did penetrate peppered my left thigh and buttock, but I was running high on endorphins, and I hardly felt them. What I did feel, as I struggled back to my feet, was a nagging insistence that something was very, very wrong. I spun around, and saw Deke lying motionless behind me, his left leg blown off at the knee. Jenna's face seemed to float before my eyes, a vision of her from the picture, superimposed on the mangled body of my best friend. An inhuman howl came from somewhere far off, and I only gradually realized that it was coming from me. I tried to talk, tried to move, but I felt like darkness was closing in on me, and I couldn't outrun it anymore. Then I saw the machine breaking through the tree line to the north. It was 12.5 meters tall and bipedal, powered by an anti-proton reactor and protected by electromagnetic deflectors and 15 centimeters of molecularly bonded armor. It was packing a proton accelerator, Gauss autocannons, and a lot of missiles like the one that took off Deke's leg. It was a damned walking starship bearing down on us from the north while the remnants of the battlesuit troops were gaining from the west. And me, I don't know what I was thinking. It was like there was this haze of red over my vision, and all I wanted to do was kill. Part of me was standing there to the side, thinking all this through logically, knowing I should pick up Deke and run for the beach, that if I didn't, we'd die. But my head comp was telling me a different story. Apparently, though I didn't remember doing it, I'd somehow picked up Deke's rifle, and I was standing there like a fucking moron, triggering electron beams and plasma fireballs at the oncoming Tawny troopers. I managed to force enough reason into whatever part of my hind brain that had taken over my body to fall into a crouch, as the electron beams and hyper-accelerated tantalum needles from the ground troops and the wash of protons from the mecha ripped up the ground around me. God only knew why I hadn't been nailed yet. Maybe it was all the burning metal fucking up their sights. Most of the battlesuits were down, but that mecha was still coming, and both weapons were running low. And then, a searing blast of coherent light speared the Tawny machine's upper chest, blowing through its armor in an explosion of sparks and metal fragments, and suddenly killing its fuel containment field. I barely had time to throw myself down before the antimatter went up, the ignition shaking the ground, the roar rattling my bones. Without the implant buffers, my eardrums would have been gone. The shock knocked me back to my senses, and I was finally able to take control of my actions again. Looking back, I saw the Raven coming to a hover above the beach, the obvious source of the shot that had saved us. But I hadn't told it to come in.
"Are you through?"
I heard Deke's voice ask, and looked back to see him leaning on one arm, his left side covered with blood, the hair and skin burned off the left side of his head, along with part of his hood. "Deke." I numbly dropped his beamer and ran back to him. "Are you all right?"
"Hell no, I'm not all right!"
Deke yelled through clenched teeth, pulling off the tattered remnants of his face hood and angrily throwing it to the ground. He was pale, and there was a lot of pain in his eyes. His biofeedback loop should have been shutting a lot of it out, and the painkillers and coagulants from his pharmacy organ would be kicking in soon. But he looked bad. The bare, silvery bone was sticking out from his knee. "Oh, God.
My fucking leg is blown off. I'm right in the middle of a fucking Tawny ambush, and you look like you're hell-bent on getting us both killed. Any more fucking stupid questions? Or can we get the fuck out of here?"
Nodding silently, I grabbed him around the waist, hefted him up with one arm, and carried him to the Raven. Its belly ramp was down and waiting for us about a meter off the ground, its belly jets kicking up a billowing cloud of dust and loose vegetation. I fairly threw Deke up the ramp, hoping the painkillers had taken effect, then leapt on board behind him.
"Get us the hell out of here!"
I yelled mentally at the ship's AI, closing the ramp behind us and hauling Deke's barely conscious form toward the cockpit. Maximum real space speed. I struggled to keep myself upright as the Raven fed power to the atmospheric jets, running scooped up air through the fusion reactor and expelling it at hypersonic speeds. We exploded through the upper atmosphere at over Mach 7, and I wished it were faster. Deke was drifting in and out of consciousness, moaning softly, but his bleeding had stopped by the time we reached the equipment bay behind the cockpit and I pulled open the automed cabinet. I leaned him against the console and began stripping off his gear. He was all blood and burned flesh on his left side, down to the ragged stump where his left calf used to be. Gritting my teeth to fight back the nausea, I lifted him up and gently sat him inside the coffin-shaped device. I paused for just a moment to make sure I had the settings right. Then I closed the lid and headed for the cockpit. "Any pursuit?" I asked the Raven, falling into the pilot's seat. We were out of the atmosphere, running off metallic hydrogen fuel until we could get far enough out of the gravity well to use the Teller Fox warp units.
"Sensors detect 3 enemy corvettes emerging from over the planet's horizon."
Bastards. I knew they'd have more ships. It wasn't a big problem, though. We had a jump on them, and this ship was built for speed as well as stealth. We were hauling around double banks of capacitors. One kept charged to let us jump at will, and the other usually left cold so we could use the warp field as a defense shield. Once we got out of orbit, I could hit the warp units and get us to a safe distance to jump to transition space. But there was that little voice again, whispering in my ear. It was too damned easy. "Active sensors forward," I snapped at Raven. Active neutrino scans were risky in this situation, but...
"Warning," Raven screamed at me. "Enemy picket ship at 3-6, 10,000 kilometers ahead."
Fuck. They'd had her sitting out there, powered down, trying to run me right into her guns. With a thought, I assumed active control of the ship and pulled her into a vertical climb out of the system's elliptical plane at full thrust, our fusion flare standing out like a beacon behind us.
"Enemy vessel is powering up his drives," Raven warned. "Corvettes are altering course to follow."
"How long to safe jump distance?"
"At present acceleration and course, 5 minutes and 21 seconds.
Still no problem. Those corvettes couldn't keep up, and although the picket ship had the power to outrun us, she'd only just activated her drives.
"Picket ship is launching a missile. Neutrino signature is consistent with a ship killer."
Oh, shit. Why would they waste one of those on us? Those things were basically an overpowered starship with a quick burnout anti-proton drive that could shunt them up to relativistic speeds. We're talking AI guidance, 20 millimeters of bonded armor, its own defense shield, and a 100 megaton fusion warhead.
"Time till intercept?" "Approximately 2 minutes and 48 seconds.
"Shit, shit, 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 shit!" "Launch all remaining missiles," I ordered. "Spread them out along the probable avoidance courses."
"Launching."
Not that I actually thought they'd stop it. And then what? If we tried to jump too close to that fucking mudball back there, the gravitational warping effect would distort our temporary wormhole, and we'd wind up scattering our atoms through both dimensions like we'd never existed. And there was no way in hell we could outrun that missile in real space. I searched quickly through the ship's databanks and found out that the closest to a planetary body anyone had ever successfully transitioned was a bit less than 8 planetary diameters away. In 2 minutes and 48 seconds, we'd be exactly 7 diameters away. Recommended jump distance was 10 diameters.
"Our intercept missiles have detonated," Raven announced. "I cannot accurately assess the damage they have done, but the ship killer is still on course and accelerating at several hundred gravities."
Good to know Tahni quality control was holding up. No choice anymore. We'd have to risk a close jump. Oh well. At least it'd be a painless death. Not a bad way to go, just fading into oblivion. I wondered, if there was an afterlife, would I see Jenna there? Or maybe this was it. Maybe this life was all we got. If that was true, I'd really fucked up. The center of my adult life had been killing people. Not humans, but still, people. If my dad was right, I was damned to hell, and the last 7 years of my life had been meaningless bullshit. If that was so, maybe it'd be better just to end it here. It was too bad Deke had to be here, though. If I knew him, he would have wanted to go out with a bang, or in bed, or both. Sorry, Deke.
It's okay, Cal.
I blinked. Had he really said that, or was I imagining things? Maybe I didn't really want to know.
10 seconds till transition.
Raven announced the results of my decision.
18 seconds till missile intercept.
Damn. I'd been sitting here thinking for a good 2 minutes. Almost missed the big moment.
9.
How'd that prayer go again? Oh, yeah. Our Father who art in heaven.
8.
Hallowed be thy name.
7.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
6.
Give us this day our daily bread.
5.
And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
4.
Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
3.
For thine is the power and the glory.
2.
Forever and ever.
1.
Amen. The very air around me seemed to swirl as the computer fed the warp unit a capacitor charge, pushing the gravimetric field to overload in a fraction of a second and creating an artificial, temporary wormhole in front of the ship. The stars twisted into a distorted rainbow ring around us, and then we were swallowed up by the living nothingness of transition space and safety. I sighed deeply, settling back in my seat and running a hand over my face. It was almost disappointing, and that was really frightening. "What's Captain Connor's condition?" I asked the ship.
"He is stable. The automed has removed the fragments and sealed his wounds with synth skin. There should be no difficulty in cloning a replacement for his leg."
So, Deke was safe, I was safe, everybody was safe. Except I didn't feel safe. I didn't feel safe at all.
Chapter 2. I'd always hated hospitals. Whether it was the med center back home at Mount Carmel, or the huge Fleet Medical Station here on Inferno, there was always this air of impersonality and claustrophobia. I guess it had to do with the idea of fixing a human body like it's a machine, but I'd always hated them. And I especially hated the reason I was there now. It was hard to recognize Deke as the distorted form floating in a clear chamber of oxygenated biotic fluid that tinted everything a pale pink. The fluid was encouraging the regrowth of severed nerves and blood vessels, preparing the stump of his lower left leg for the graft of the new one growing in the clone tanks. It'd be another day or so before he was ready for the graft, and another couple weeks after that before he'd be up and around. But he'd never been in any real danger. Except for me. I turned suddenly at the sound of the treatment room's door hissing open and two officers stepping inside. The first was a tall, broad-bodied man with a regal bearing and ebon skin. His eyes had the piercing intensity of a laser, and he seemed to command respect without saying a word. Major Matthew Mvoba. He'd been a natural leader among all of us who'd survived the fateful attack on the Academy training ship Thatcher, and that had carried over to his higher rank and position as second in command of the group. The other, The other looked like a file clerk. He had an unremarkable face and the body to go with it, despite the age of body restruct that we lived in. And soft, almost weepy eyes. It was all a lie. A natural camouflage job. Colonel Antonin Murdoch was as hard and dangerous as a burst of gamma rays. He was our commander, our creator in many ways, and one of Admiral Sato's golden boys. When President Jameson had put Sato in charge of Space Fleet, he'd swept a whole new generation of officers into command positions, including Bulldog Murdoch. And it was the Bulldog who'd had this idea about a special, physically augmented psychological operations team to put the fear of God into the Tahni.
"He's going to be okay."
Matt's voice was a boulder crashing on a field of gravel. "I know." I nodded gratefully. "Let's take a walk," Murdoch said without preamble, then turned and strode purposefully out of the room, leaving me with no choice but to follow. We were silent as we walked quickly through the hospital corridors, all white walls and white uniforms, and finally emerged into the bright mid-afternoon glare from too near 82 Eridani. The medical center was right in the middle of the base, and there was activity all around us. The crackling roar of ascending spacecraft was underpinned by the whine of electric motors from the ground cars that filled the street. The spaceport was a white, blockish edifice that loomed above us, the upper control decks of cargo haulers poking up above its open bays. "Talk to me, Cal," the colonel said abruptly, staring at a cargo shuttle that rose slowly up above the port on torches of superheated air. "What happened out there?" I hesitated before answering him. He'd undoubtedly seen the mission record I dumped out of my head comp into the command system, so he knew what had happened. He wanted to know what had happened to me. "I fucked up," I admitted with a helpless shrug. "Lost my head. If Deke hadn't taken control of the ship at the beach, we'd have both died or been captured." "Don't try to play the martyr with me." Murdoch's voice was soft as a priest's, but the words were hard, like an atomic blast. "I know you fucked up. I want to know why." I had to think about that for a second. How would I explain this to a man who'd always seemed almost inhuman? "Colonel," I began hesitantly, "you know where I'm from. When I decided to attend the academy, I gave up my family, most of my friends, even my religion, because I thought I owed something to the Commonwealth, to the rest of humanity. That sense of duty's what's kept me going." I turned away from him to stare at the jungle to the east and the mountains they ran into. After a while, I began to lose that. The killing, the murder, it felt like, and the way we did it, ripping their throats out. The feeling that I wasn't quite human anymore, it was getting to me. Then I met Jenna. She... I tried to search for the words. She was everything I thought I'd given up. Life, and hope, and humanity. My throat tightened, and my voice threatened to break. Since she died, I've been running on one goal. Killing as many of them as I can before I die. Deke and the rest of us, we have a word for what happens when our head comp takes over. We call it the machine. The last few months, I've been letting the machine run me, Colonel. I've been letting it use me instead of me using it. I haven't been thinking about anything else, even Deke. When I saw him there with his leg blown off,
I realized that the machine had let me do that to him. And all I could think was that everything I had to hold on to was gone. I trailed off, and things fell into an awkward silence. I think I understand, Murdoch said with a nod, but his tone was its same inevitable neutrality, and I didn't know if he really understood or not. He put a hand on my shoulder, and I turned to face him.
Cal, I like you. I think I like you more than any of the others. But I'll tell you to your face that I'm your military commander, and I have to see you not as a human being, but as a military asset. You're too valuable to the group and to the Commonwealth for me to let you throw your life away. You don't have that luxury. You embody a huge financial investment by the government. You're gonna have to jack yourself back up.
He waved a hand expansively.
We've got some time. None of you will be going out again until we can analyze this new enemy strategy. The others are either on base already or on their way in. We may have to change tactics completely. In the meantime, I want you to talk to Dr. Rajiv. Tell her what you've told me. Then you can take some R&R. Go to Eden for a few days and loosen up. Find yourself a girl and have some fun. You gotta pull yourself out of this. It's important for all of us.
I'll try, sir, I acknowledged with a nod. What else could I say?
I know you will, Cal.
He patted me on the shoulder and walked away without another word. He was right. I had to pull out of this. But I hated the prospect of bearing my soul to Dr. Rajiv. She meant well. She'd been our official psych counselor for the last 2 years. But she wasn't one of us, and she couldn't understand just how isolated we were. I supposed it couldn't hurt, though, and it was just as likely to work as anything else. With a heavy sigh, I turned and headed for her office. Might as well get it over with. I could just hear it now, though.
What do you think the problem is, Caleb?
Carrie Rajiv, registered psychological counselor, asked me in that oh-so-caring voice she had patented. All this introspection, I knew, was a ploy. The whole earth-toned, homey office was wired with MRIs, voice stress analyzers, thermal scanners, EKGs, EEGs, and fucking alpha wave detectors, for God's sake. And it was all fed to a readout in her head comp. They didn't want us to know, because we boys could mask much of that if we tried. But why bother? They wouldn't pull me off the line permanently, and the shit they'd implanted assured me they couldn't wipe my personality without activating my fail-safes. All she could do was give advice, both to me and to our superiors. I guess I'm just missing Jenna, I replied with a shrug, wondering what she expected me to say.
She wouldn't have wanted you to take unnecessary risks, would she?
Dr. Rajiv countered, her dark eyes calculating, yet somehow interested at the same time.
If she loved you, she'd want you to go on with your life.
I don't have much of what you'd call a life, Doc. I chuckled humorlessly. Mostly, I just kill people.
It's a war, Captain Mitchell. She reminded me gently. You knew what the job would be when you took it. Forgive me for being brutally direct, but is this an attack of conscience or merely self-pity?
Don't have much of a conscience anymore either, I allowed with a shrug. So I guess if those are the only two choices, it must be self-pity. I smiled with false enthusiasm.
Gosh, we've solved it already. Can I go now? Please, Captain Mitchell.
She sighed.
I know you and the rest of your teammates don't like me or the job I do, but
I don't dislike you, Dr. Rajiv, I told her frankly, squirming in my seat. I just
don't know you. It's hard to trust someone you don't know with things you don't even want to admit to yourself.
So who could you admit them to?
She asked me, and I suddenly had the feeling that the sigh of frustration had been just as calculated as anything else she did. Good fucking question, though. Who could I talk to anymore? Deke, I guess, I told her. Really no one else.
And I bet you can't even tell him most of it, right?
It wasn't really a question, but I found myself nodding anyway.
Well, Captain, she said in resignation, under more peaceful circumstances, I would prescribe a full regimen of psychological counseling for you and bar you from any active duty for at least a month.
She shrugged.
Things being what they are, I'd say you should try to blow off some steam. Find someone else you can talk to. If not someone you trust, then at least someone you don't know and will never see again.
She grinned crookedly.
In other words, go to Eden, find some willing girl, and get yourself laid.
It was good advice, but I couldn't do it. I couldn't find the energy inside me to make the effort, and I knew it would be a disaster if I did. I would have been banging some joy girl on Eden and thinking about Jenna. What the hell was the point of that? So, instead, I was sitting there in the lounge outside our quarters, afraid to go back to my own room because I knew if I did, I'd just sit there and stare at her picture. Or worse, replay memories of her on my head comp. There was some veer drama playing in the lounge's central holotank, but I didn't bother to jack in. I'd have probably wound up killing all the characters. I wasn't sure how long I'd been sitting there. I could have found out, could have asked my head comp with a thought, but I didn't want to know. Maybe if I sat there long enough, I thought, the war would be over. The door to the lounge hissed open, and I looked up, half expecting, against all reason, to see Deke enter. But instead, it was Brian Hammer and Holly Moray. They couldn't have completed their mission and returned already, so I guess they'd been recalled after the news of our little debacle. Brian passed by me with a perfunctory, supportive clap on my shoulder, no emotion passing across his simple, broad-boned face. But Holly hesitated beside me, frowning with concern. Holly had always been our big sister, and more to some of us. At least she didn't ask me if I was going to be okay.
Do you want to talk, Cal?
She said instead. I looked up at her, knowing what she meant and thinking, yeah, that might be a good idea. At least she was a friend, not some anonymous body. Okay, I said with a nod, and followed her to her quarters. Her room was oddly girly. Well, she was a girl, almost literally. We were all pretty young, chronologically at least. But the rest of us seemed to have grown, not just up, but almost old. Not Holly, though. Her quarters reminded me of Rachel's room back home, right down to the stuffed animals on the bed. I remembered the first time I had snuck into Rachel's room. It seemed like a lifetime ago. Holly shut the door behind us as I wandered over to her dresser, glancing at holos of her family back on Earth. She was short like her mother and shared her green eyes, but she had her father's oval face and his reddish-brown hair, though in the picture, his was long and flowing, whereas hers was cut short and spiky. I idly wondered if they'd planned her that way or just let nature take its course, the way we did on Canaan. Beside her in the picture was her little sister, Callie, all curls and dimples.
I felt a gut-punch sensation as I realized how hard it must have been for Holly, not being able to talk to her family.
"Do you miss your family, Cal?"
she asked me softly. I turned back towards her and saw that she'd shed her reflex suit and was standing before me nude. I took a moment to appreciate her toned, hard body, and I experienced a stirring I hadn't felt in weeks. "All the time," I replied to her question. I could see the glint in her eye as she noticed the hesitation in my answer from checking her out. "But I don't think my father misses me too much." I was dressed in standard utility fatigues. We didn't wear the reflex suits when we were in garrison. And Holly stepped close to me and began unfastening the front of it. I smelled the strawberry scent she was using in her hair, felt the warmth of her bare skin.
"That's right,"
she said, nodding, as casual as if she weren't undressing me.
"Your dad is a pacifist, right?"
She pulled my fatigue top off my chest, her fingers brushing softly against my skin, as hot as a fusion drive. "My whole planet is," I told her, fighting to control my breathing and heart rate as both wanted to speed up. "New society of friends. Neo-Quakers."
"I've heard of them."
Her hands unfastened the connectors of my pants, sliding them down my legs.
"There are a lot of religious splinter groups on the frontier colonies."
Unable to maintain a casual pretense anymore, I leaned in and kissed her, pulling her against me as our lips met, then opened, our tongues entwining, my hands traveling over her soft skin to places they'd been before, if not recently. Much later, lying side by side on her bed, she restarted the conversation as if 2 hours of sex hadn't interrupted it.
"So, your family didn't take your leaving too well,"
she said, her fingers running affectionately across the skin of my left arm as I faced her.
"What about your friends?"
"Most of them didn't understand," I replied with a shrug. "My girlfriend Rachel, hell, we probably would have wound up married. She was really hurt by it. She thought I was abandoning her personally." I thought about her, a vision of a teenage girl with long brown hair and gray eyes, an easy smile and a laugh like a spring shower, walking hand in hand through the woods behind my family's farm, making love in the maintenance shed on a blanket. "I miss her," I said, more open and unafraid to be myself than I could ever be with our team psychologist. "I used to think about her a lot, but after I met Jenna..." A knife twisted in my gut, and I forced down those feelings. "Anyway, the only one who really understood was my best friend, Jason Chen. His family was from off-world. They worked for the Agricultural Survey Board. They weren't friends. People didn't hang around him much, except me." Chapter 3. Then. I wiped sweat from my forehead with a rag and grimaced as it came away covered with dirt and grease. It was the middle of the day on Canaan, 30 Earth days into the 62 that this side of the world would face our star, Goshen, and I was busting my ass trying to repair a broke-down harvester motor in time to bring in the last 4,000 acres of wheat, in time to plant another 4,000 acres before the night and the storms it brought that would make any outdoor work impossible for weeks. "Cal!" I heard a voice calling to me from down the dirt road that led to our house and barn. "Cal! Are you out here?" I didn't need to look up to know who it was. The voice was higher pitched than any native Canaanite male over the age of 10, and had the odd lilt of someone born on old Earth, on the Asian continent. At least, that's what Jason's family had told me. I'd never met anyone else from Earth. I hopped down from the maintenance catwalk on the side of the machine, absorbing the fall with bent knees as I watched Jason Chan running towards me, his feet kicking up dust from the road. It always seemed unnatural watching Jason run. He was nearly 2 meters tall, making him a giant on Canaan, where gravity half again that of Earth tended to breed short and stocky people. When he ran, it was with a clumsiness that made it look like he was always about to go out of control and smash into the ground in a heap of shattered bones. He had put on a lot of muscle in the 6 years he and his family had been on planet, but he still seemed as emaciated as a skeleton by our standards. At least he dressed like a local now, in utilitarian work clothes, and not the gaudy flash he'd worn as a 12-year-old. He'd been teased quite a bit at school about that, and his height, and his accent, until I'd knocked a few heads together. Most people still treated Jace like an off-worlder, but we'd been best friends ever since. "What's up, Jace?" I asked him, grinning a little as he skidded to a halt in a tangle of long black hair. He'd started trying to grow a beard last year, and that wasn't working out too well. "Why you running? Your bike broken down again?"
"Shit,"
he said, blinking as if he'd just woken up, then pausing to wipe sweat out of his eyes.
"I forgot and left it at home."
I goggled at him. "You ran all the way here from your house? That's like 5 kilometers.
"Yeah, I guess."
He shrugged it off.
"You haven't heard then? You don't have your link with you?"
"It's in the barn." I waved over at the large aluminum structure that was barely visible 0.5 kilometer back down the road. The house was another kilometer past that. Last time I brought my data link with me to work on the harvester, I dropped it into the motor and it took me 3 days to get it out. I frowned at him. "It's pretty hot out here. You want some water?" I grabbed my canteen off the side of my four-wheeler and offered it to him.
"Jesus, Cal."
He sighed, and I felt my lip curl downward instinctively. Usually, Jace was careful not to blaspheme. I didn't say anything about it because we were friends, but it would get him shunned by the other church members if they'd heard it.
"We're at war,"
he said, and his too high voice seemed to lower octaves in my head. "War?" I repeated in disbelief. "With the Tahni?" It was a stupid question, and I knew it even as it left my mouth. Who else would we be at war with? The Tahni were the only other intelligent alien species in the cluster, as far as we knew, and certainly the only other species with FTL. Anyway, I didn't think Jace would have run 5 kilometers to tell me if we were raiding the pirate worlds or something. He was nodding anyway, ignoring the inanity of my question.
"Yeah, they attacked 6 squatter colonies in the disputed systems, wiped them out to the last. 500,000 dead, they say."
"Holy shit," I murmured, eyes losing focus as I tried to take in a number like that. The squatter colonists had been warned that it was dangerous to set up homesteads on the disputed territories at the edge of the Tahni neutral zone, but habitable and hospitable worlds, while not exactly rare, weren't common enough to ignore. "I mean, I thought they might blockade them or something," I qualified. "But to just kill everyone? Holy shit."
"President Jameson is sending an expedition out there right now," Jason told me. "They're already starting construction on more cruisers at the Martian shipyards, and some people are even talking about a military draft."
"A draft?" I heard a squeak in my voice and scowled angrily. I was almost 18, too old for my voice to be breaking. "Not out here, though, right?" He shook his head,
sweat whipping off his long hair.
"I don't know, man,"
he said, then seemed to stumble a step.
"Whoa, I think I will have a drink of water."
I handed him the canteen, almost absent-mindedly, my brain churning around the idea of winding up drafted into the military.
We should get a religious waiver, though, I reasoned. They wouldn't force the friends to serve in the military, would they?
No, he admitted, almost grudgingly. Jason always had a flair for the dramatic.
But they might put you into key non-combatant roles, like working in industrial services.
He took a long swallow of water before he pointed a finger decisively.
I know they'll want to put an orbital defense system out here, and that'll go over like a pleasure doll at Sunday services.
No shit, I agreed, letting him take another swig before I took the canteen back and threw it in the cargo cage on the back of my four-wheeler. Come on, I said to him, jerking my head towards the vehicle. I'll give you a ride back to your house, if you don't mind riding bitch.
My dad doesn't like that term,
Jason reminded me, clambering on behind me.
He says it's sexist and regressive.
Yeah? I started the motor and revved it a couple times before putting the cycle in gear. Well, my dad says that anyone who doesn't like it here can go back to Earth or go to hell. We both laughed, and I could feel him having to grab the rear handholds to stay on as the four-wheeler hit a patch of rough ground.
Hey, let's head into town first,
Jason said, yelling over the hum of the motor.
I heard there's a bunch of people getting together there.
Maybe for a little while, I said doubtfully. I still have work to do. Town didn't mean Harristown, the capital. That was the city, and it was a flight away, not a short drive. Even New Jerusalem, which was smaller and a bit closer, was too far to go on a regular basis. No, for us kids, town meant Lebanon. It was little more than a local shipping hub, where trucks brought in raw materials that couldn't be harvested locally, and the local farmers came in with their power wagons and hauled their supplies back to their homesteads. But anywhere there were more than two buildings sitting next to each other, there was going to be a stop-and-eat kind of place. And when it was the only place around for a few dozen square kilometers, it was going to attract the local kids. Yoders had been around nearly as long as the colony, but hadn't grown one square meter in that whole time. It was a shack, mostly built from local wood, except for the kitchen, which had been poured from the last canister of build foam left over after the shipping warehouse had been laid out. The place had never been favored by the church elders, but they'd never gone as far as shutting it down, just restricted it from expanding, which meant that its half a dozen tables were always taken, and most people wound up leaning on the wooden bar that went all the way around the shack. The bar was packed when Jason and I arrived, and I pulled the four-wheeler into the lot between Yoder's and the shipping station next door. Then we headed to the order window and got in line behind a few other kids.
Cal!
I heard a female voice behind me and turned to see Rachel running up with her friend Lisa in tow. Rachel Lowenstein and her family lived on the farm north of our property, and I'd been in love with her since I was 10. It had only taken another 6 years before she'd felt the same way. She was tall for a girl. Well, tall for a Canaanite girl. Jason says we're all trolls compared to normal people. With curves in all the right places, and sandy blonde hair tied into twin braids. She was, I thought, the most beautiful girl on the entire planet. Hey, Rach, I said, smiling as she stepped up and gave me a quick kiss, after a glance around to make sure no adults were watching. A couple of kids made catcalls, but we ignored them.
Have you guys heard the news?
Lisa asked breathlessly, her dark eyes shining with interest. Lisa Stanfell was even taller than Rachel, and too skinny for my tastes, with dark brown hair cut short.
Isn't it crazy?
I never thought it would happen.
It was inevitable,
Jason argued, shaking his head in that tone that had gotten him picked on in school.
Maybe if there was never a transition drive and everyone still had to use the wormhole jump gates, the truce could have lasted. But with anyone with a ship able to jump into any system, there was no way the neutral zone was going to last. I'm just surprised it took this long.
Oh yeah, Mr. Professor?
That was Harry Paskowski. His grandfather owned the largest farm in the whole area. He thought that made him hot shit. I thought he looked like a moron with his scraggly beard and fat nose and pretentiously flashy clothes. Also, he kept trying to cozy up to Rachel, constantly giving gifts to her mom and talking about how their families should unite.
So tell us then,
he went on in his whiny voice.
What's gonna happen?
What do you think happens in war, Harry?
Jason said, cocking his head towards him in a mocking pose.
People are gonna die. 500,000 civilian colonists, just like us, are already dead.
Not like me,
Harry spluttered, half laughing.
Bunch of outlaw squatters on a worthless ball of dirt, scratching out a living like animals.
They were still people, Harry,
Rachel said, disapproval in her eyes, and I had to suppress a grin. That made him tone it down a notch, but the look on his face was still condescending.
Okay, I'm sorry,
he said, to Rachel, not Jason.
But they were squatting on a planet the Tahni think is theirs. It's not like they didn't know there was danger.
They were being reckless, Jason agreed. But it doesn't matter now. The truce has officially been suspended. Jameson is gonna retaliate.
If you're that worried about it,
Harry scoffed,
why don't you go join up?
I'm thinking I might,
Jason said, shrugging and looking away. I did a double take.
What?
I demanded, grabbing his arm and turning him towards me.
When did that happen?
You're going into the academy, Jason?
Lisa asked, her eyes wide.
No, not the academy,
he corrected her, shaking his head.
My test scores aren't high enough. I was thinking of enlisting.
Since when? I asked him again, but he didn't meet my eyes right away.
For a while now,
he admitted quietly.
I mean, primary school's over for us now, and it's not like there's a university on this planet that offers the education I'm looking for. It's either the military or apply for a scholarship. And like I said,
he shrugged.
My test scores aren't that high. If I serve, I get tuition and transportation to any off-world school I want after my first enlistment.
Those tests are messed up,
Lisa said, a little anger in her voice.
You're one of the smartest guys I know.
Thanks, Lisa,
Jason said, and I rolled my eyes at the sudden shy meekness of his tone. I knew he liked Lisa, but he'd never made a move on her, despite hours of encouragement from me.
Anyway, he went on, I already have the enlistment request filled out. I was just waiting to tell my parents first.
My dad would shit a brick if I told him I was joining the military,
Lisa commented, giggling a little in spite of the gravity of the situation.
Jason's family aren't friends,
Harry reminded her, a bit snidely, I thought. But then I thought everything he said came across as snide. He was right, though. Besides being off-worlders, the Chens weren't part of the church. They weren't even believers in anything, though I'd cautioned Jason the first time we met not to spread that around. From what he told me, a lot of people on Earth and the larger colonies thought the same way. I didn't think I could live that way.
They'll be okay with it,
Jace said, half sounding like he was trying to convince himself.
Either way, I'm doing it,
he decided.
You kids gonna order something?
Old Yoder asked us, with a voice like gravel mixed with broken glass. I didn't know his first name, Everyone just called him Old Yoder. He looked weathered and had an air of world-weariness to him, which suited a man who had to be well over 150 years old by now. There was no one on the planet older than him, and only a few of the church elders that could come close to matching his years. "Yeah, I'll have a vanilla shake," I told him, fishing a couple trade notes out of my pants pockets. Jace told me, and I'd seen on the news nets I'd watched at his parents' house, that most people in the larger colonies and everyone on Earth used electronic accounts for payments and never used physical cash. But that had never taken hold here. Maybe because the church frowned on people having holotanks and watching the entertainment feeds from the Instel commsats.
"No one here cares how they do things anywhere else,"
was how my father had put it whenever I'd broached the subject. His voice was still echoing in my head when I heard it echo in my ears.
"Caleb Mitchell," he growled. "Why the devil are you wasting time in this altar to idle hands instead of fixing that harvester?"
I turned so fast I dropped the shake on the ground, and it splattered all over the place, narrowly missing Jason and Rachel's shoes. Standing just 3 meters behind me were Dad, Isaac, and Pete, lined up like a row of nesting dolls, each with a matching accusatory glare, even if Pete's was mostly done in a 10-year-old's miniature imitation of his father and older brother. Church elder Jacob Mitchell reminded me of those ancient statues from old Earth that I'd seen in history class in school. His face was a perpetual, disapproving frown, avoiding imperiousness only because he found things in himself to disapprove of as well. I shared the Mitchell family's broad, open face and dirty blonde hair with him and Isaac and Pete, though my hair was cut fairly short, while Dad's was tied into a ponytail and darker in his full beard. Isaac's was shaggier with a handlebar mustache, and Pete's was a youngster's unruly mane. And Isaac certainly shared our father's disapproving frown, for all that he was only 7 years older than me. "Sorry, Dad," I stuttered, caught totally off guard, my eyes flashing back and forth from his grim visage to the mess on the ground, and wondering if I dared to clean it up at that moment. "I was working on it, but then Jason came to tell me the news. Did you hear? It's the Tahni. They blew up a bunch of colonies, and now we're at war with them again."
"We aren't at war with anyone,"
Dad corrected me, expression growing even darker, if that was possible.
"Maybe your unbeliever friend and his people are at war, but that is none of our concern. Your concern should be repairing that harvester so that our people don't go hungry during the night."
"Don't expect me to do your chores for you, Caleb,"
Isaac warned, talking down his nose to me, as he always did.
"I have my own responsibilities."
"It's almost done," I insisted, a flash of familiar anger at Isaac straightening my back and drowning out the intimidation I always felt when Dad lectured me. "I'll have it back in the fields before dinner."
"All right, then,"
my father said with a sigh.
"I have to get the wagon loaded with feed and get it back to the stables. Make sure that harvester is running before you come home."
"Yes, sir," I said, nodding. "But Dad, what about the war? What happens if the Tahni attack here?"
"They left us be in the last war. They'll leave us be now as well."
He waved a hand dismissively, turning back towards the shipping depot.
"My father didn't bring our family here to fight the Commonwealth's wars. Concentrate on the important things, Caleb."
I didn't say anything, just watched them walk away, Isaac shooting me another look of disapproval before they disappeared around the corner. "Well, that was bad timing," Jason cracked, and I had to chuckle. He'd never been cowed by my father, and I envied him that. "Think you can find another ride home, Jace?" I asked him.
"We can give him a ride,"
Rachel said,
hand gripping mine, coming close enough that I could smell the scent of her shampoo and feel the brush of her breast against my arm. And suddenly, my mind was on something other than the war. She leaned in close and whispered to me,
"Think you can get away after dinner?"
"I'll message you," I nodded, grinning broadly at the thought of sneaking into her bedroom, as I had so many times over the last 2 years. Sometimes I wondered if her mom knew and just didn't care. Mrs. Lowenstein seemed detached sometimes. I said my goodbyes to Jace and the others, then went to find my four-wheeler. Maybe Jason was right about the war, or maybe my dad was. But life here wasn't going to stop either way, and I had to get back to work. Chapter 4. I stared at the screen, my finger hovering above the submit button, chewing on the edge of my lip nervously.
"Just do it," Jason urged me, rolling his eyes. "For God's sake, you're not committing to anything. It's just an application."
"Don't blaspheme, man," I muttered absently. "You know I don't like it." I sucked in a deep breath and touched submit. And the form I'd filled out vanished from the screen and was replaced by a confirmation that my application to the Commonwealth Service Academy had been successfully submitted, and that I could expect to hear a reply within 14 solar days. The breath escaped in a ragged sigh, and I sat back heavily in the chair, turning it away from the Chen's decades-old entertainment center. Jason complained constantly that it wasn't a holotank like they'd had back on Earth, but at least he had a connection to the commsats, which was more than any of the rest of us had. "If Dad finds out about this," I lamented softly, "I'm dead."
"He won't kill you," Jason assured me, nudging my arm. "You guys are pacifists, right?"
I glared at him balefully. "I can't believe I let you talk me into this."
"Cal,"
he said pleadingly, his hands going up in frustration,
"your test scores are higher than anyone else in our graduating class. You're wasting your time picking crops for your dad here on the ass end of the Commonwealth."
"What are your folks doing here then?" I retorted, waving around us. The Chen's house was laid out differently than most of the others I'd been in anywhere around here. There was no family altar, for one thing, and of course they had the entertainment center with its large display screen mounted on one wall, with three smaller personal screens lower down for input. Swivel chairs were in front of each personal screen.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.